afraid you're being influenced by a way of thinking, an unnatural. Do you remember the woman on TV?
Honey, we think you're a lesbian.
At first glance, the 1999 film, But I'm a Cheerleader, directed by Jamie Babbitt, might seem like a depressing story. It focuses on a teenage cheerleader, Megan, who gets sent to a religious reparative therapy camp, otherwise known as conversion therapy, when her friends and family suspect that she's a lesbian. A film tackling such serious issues could have easily gone the more dismal route with its storytelling, as seen with The Miseducation of Cameron Post, but Babbitt instead wanted it to feel like a gay Clueless. With its bright visuals, quirky characters, and cheery music, it's no wonder this film has become a cult classic, especially among queer audiences. This video essay will analyze the mise-en-scene of But I'm a Cheerleader and discuss the meaning it added to the story of the film. As Babbitt herself stated, the look of the film is Barbie Dreamhouse meets Edward Scissorhands. Everything seen on screen contributes to this effect, from the set and costume design to the props and even to the way that actors are placed within the shot. This is what's known as mise-en-scene. If you know what you're doing, you can take advantage of these visual elements to add more depth to the story, which is exactly what But I'm a Cheerleader did. Costuming was an important element that was used very thoughtfully throughout the film. In the snippets we see of Megan's life before being sent to the reparative camp, True Directions, everyone is dressed in various shades of brown, even Megan herself. The cheer uniform she wears is orange, but it still matches with the brown and tan tones that surround her. By contrast, RuPaul's character, ex-gay Mike, is the first person to wear a different color. But what's interesting about his outfit is that although it's monochromatic like everyone else in the movie so far, it's of a bright blue instead of boring brown. This shows that even though he does stand out from the norms of Megan's world, he's still living within the restrictions of a different sort of norm, that of the camp founder, Mary Brown. As the movie progresses, costume and set design go hand in hand. Just as the people in Megan's home life were dressed fully in brown, so were the sets. Megan woke up in a brown bedroom, prepared food in a brown kitchen, and then went to her brown school and drove home with her boyfriend in a brown car with brown seats. Her whole life was neutral and bland until she was sent to True Directions. Upon arrival, she's thrust into a world of bright colors and false niceties. Each camper is forced to dress head to toe in the color that corresponds with their gender, pink for girls and blue for boys. The blue and pink house stands out like a sore thumb among the dead grass that covers the property, as does the bright fence that surrounds it. And inside is a whole other universe of color that is nothing like what Megan had in her normal day-to-day life. Each room is a different color, and each is furnished perfectly symmetrically. The large bedroom for the girls feels very much like a Barbie playset, with everything in the room being pink, down to the crinkly plastic that covers the bedsheets and pillows during the day. It's certainly following a specific, albeit blinding, aesthetic, but in doing so, it makes it feel unlivable. The house feels more like a dollhouse rather than somewhere that's meant to house a group of teenagers for several weeks at a time. When you consider the intentions of True Directions, this can be a bit confusing. Why would a camp that aims to supposedly help these quote-unquote brainwashed kids to realize their true heterosexual self not be decorated in neutral tones that matches with what the real world looks like? It seems like that would be almost counterproductive, wouldn't it? Or at the very least, just plain misaligned with its goals. But the thing is, it actually does line up with the true intentions of this camp. All Mary cares about is maintaining appearances. Even though she tries to make it seem as though the camp is mostly successful in converting people away from being gay, the truth is that that's not what's going on at all. What's truly happening is that it's just ingraining a set of rules that these kids must all follow in order to be perceived as heterosexual. Another visual element that's crucial to the storytelling of the film is the blocking of the characters. There are several scenes where the characters create symmetry just by the way they're positioned on the set, which shows that these characters are following in suit with the guidelines Mary is giving them. What's interesting is that Graham, Megan's eventual love interest, tends to be positioned in a way that breaks that symmetry. For instance, in this scene, we see that Megan and Hillary are following Mary's directions as they vacuum. The shot is very balanced and pleasing to the eye, interrupted only by Graham, who sits in a manner traditionally considered unladylike as she watches the girls clean with disdain. In this scene, Mary has taken the campers to protest outside the house of two ex-ex-gays with offensive signs and a megaphone. Once the two men come out of their house and yell back at them, all of the teens flee into the van, except for Graham and Megan. What's interesting about this scene, however, is that while Megan doesn't move one bit, Graham does, only to stop behind the hood of the van. This is reflective of the inner turmoil the characters are facing at the moment. Megan has at this point already admitted to herself that she is attracted to Graham, and so she doesn't find herself following along with the rest of the kids, who are still trying to follow Mary's teachings and turn themselves into ex-gays. Graham is worried because she knows her parents will disown her if she doesn't graduate from the camp. Despite having been unabashedly vocal early on about her lesbianism, this fear keeps her from confidently standing by Megan's side, and so she instead opts for looking on from behind the safety of the van's hood. The camper's stay at True Direction culminates in a graduation. Wide shots of the venue, which is really just a lawn on the camp's lot, shows that the guests dressed in all white are seated on white seats before a white pavilion framed by white trellises. This, combined with the fact that the graduates are the only ones wearing color, makes the graduation feel like a reversal of the traditional Christian wedding. By having the graduation mirror the aesthetics of a wedding, we see that she's essentially symbolically marrying these kids to the heteronormative values she has been drilling into their heads for the past few weeks. In addition to being the only ones wearing colors, the graduates are also the only ones not wearing clothes made of fabric. Instead, their dresses, or suits, are of shiny plastic that reflect the sun and crinkle as they walk. This not only highlights the physical discomfort the graduates are feeling, but also the irony of these clearly queer teenagers being celebrated for basically just fooling everyone into believing they're now heterosexual. Megan's character development is seen in full in this graduation scene by her wardrobe alone. When she was kicked out of True Direction, she had changed back into her normal beige-toned clothes. Her parents had already let her know that if she failed out of this camp, she wouldn't be allowed back home, and so she finds solace with the two XXKs who had appeared earlier in the film. And when she decides to sneak back to True Direction to convince Graham to leave with her, she dons the gray camo that those XXKs had worn when the campers were protesting outside their home. This shows that she now has new role models to look up to. Instead of trying to fit into the styles of clothing that her classmates wore, or the clothes that fit the gender roles enforced by Mary, she now feels a part of the community provided to her through these two kind gay men. When Graham says she won't go with her, Megan resorts to the version of herself that makes her feel more confident, and she puts her cheer uniform back on and wins Graham back. This is important because it shows that even though she's had the life-changing revelation that she is a lesbian, it still doesn't change anything about her love for cheerleading. As Babbitt said, she had wanted to see a movie with a girl who embraces her lesbianism and femininity at the same time, and that's exactly what Megan does. Being a cheerleader is important to who she is, so she sticks with it, even if it isn't something that's stereotypically lesbian. Staying true to herself helps her win the girl, and they have their fairy tale happy ending as they kiss in front of the pretty clouds painted on their truck's back window. Ultimately, But I'm a Cheerleader is a film critiquing the ridiculousness of gender roles, gay stereotypes, heteronormativity, and the people who enforce any of these ideals, using comedy and visual language to accomplish that. The usage of mise-en-scene through blocking and set and costume design was integral for conveying the subtext of the story, as well as just adding to the campy feel of this lesbian romantic comedy. I'm certain that this film can only grow more beloved as time turns on.